Welcome back to The Breakfast here on Plus TV Africa. Let's go straight to our newspapers and see what we can find. We're kicking off with the Punch newspapers this morning, and we'll be sharing with you. Experts fault CBN government, NASG says 60 billion naira printing not sustainable. Also, federal government recorded 485.51 billion naira fiscal deficit in January. That's from the CBN. Oil and gas export revenue fell by $2.23 billion in 2020. That's from the NNPC. And also, military to embark on massive recruitment, says minister. Pro-Taliban comments, sack Pantami now, PDP CSOs tell Buhari. Also on the Punch this morning, NDLEA seizes 834 kilograms drugs. Traffickers excrete 191 wraps of cocaine. Ooh. Gunmen abduct Fulani man, demand 7 million naira in Oyo. And also Amoteco arrest herders and 250 cows over a 300-hectare farm destruction. We can also find here, about to wed, four others killed as bus plunges into Ondo River. And insurance didn't cover Lagos buses burnt during NSARS. And that is from the governor of the Lagos state, Babajide Sanwo-Olu. 23 killed as vigilantes and Fulani traders clash in Zamfara.
On the Nigerian Tribune, PDP, others mount pressure on Buhari to sack Pantami. PDP adds that the DSS should also investigate him. Middle Belt Forum wants Pantami to resign, and Murike is saying Pantami should not succumb to what they call blackmail. Global COVID-19 death toll surpasses 3 million. Yakasa is here saying neither APC nor PDP can redeem Nigeria. PDP governors are saying CBN's threat to states over Obaseki's claim shows governance has plummeted. 18.17% inflation rate, not healthy for economy. That's according to the Manufacturers Association of Nigeria. How Nigeria lost 15,000 megawatts to gas flaring in 6 years. Serap writes Buhari, sixth probe of missing 106 billion naira in 149 MDAs in 2018. Don't listen to secessionist, FG tells Nigerians. School children abductions, finance minister to engage NSA, service chiefs, others. Farm destruction, Ondo to auction seized cows. Ex-militants here telling the Ondo state government, don't make us regret submitting our arms and ammunition. Six killed as 18-seater bus plunges into river in Ondo. 73 missing, about 2,000 displaced as gunmen attacks Taraba community. 12 bodies recovered in Benue tanker explosion. And other stories here that we've touched on the Punch newspaper.
All right, let's see what we can find on the Daily Independent. Crude oil price recovery not enough to ease forex woes. Different exchange rates still weigh down on forex market. Also, many fear dead as 18-seater bus plunges into river in Ondo state. Headsmen kill family of five and three others in Benue. Six killed in Ekiti cult war. 10 suspects arrested. PDP debunks purported suspension of Kwankwaso Babangida Aliyu. And also, Serap urges Buhari to probe alleged missing 106 billion naira in 149 MDAs. Tickets sold out. Airline staff and touts fingered in blocked seats. And we can also find here, don't listen to secessionists, federal government tells Nigerians. Also, Labour rejects federal government appointments into new colleges of education. Lastly, printing of 60 billion naira. Federal government should heed Obaseki's advice, PDP and governors tell APC counterparts.
Going now to another newspaper, looking at the Daily Trust. Terrorism financing. Dozens arrested in nationwide crackdown. BDC operators, gold dealers, others netted. Billions trapped. More businessmen marked for arrest. PDP wades in as Kano chapter crisis deepens. Troops and Boko Haram in gun duel over Dikwa. Rising cement and steel prices. Owners abandon houses under construction. There is also media frenzy over the health of the president on the Daily Trust.
All right, and we'll say good morning once again to Tunde Kolawole, who's joining us. Thanks for your time this morning.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, good morning right. again.
There's a lot of interesting stories. I'm not sure which you would like to start from.
Well, maybe I should start from the Bantami story. It is unfortunate that the nation, once again, is being faced with this kind of very, very embarrassing situation. You and I will know that there has been a lot of people who have in the past alerted the nation that the sympathizers of the Islamic fundamentalists have infiltrated most of the government structures in Nigeria. And you will recollect that Dr. Goodluck Jonathan, even as city president, had had cause to say that he strongly suspects that there are Boko Haram and Islamic fundamentalists within the structures of government. When you have those kind of people in the structure of government, chances are that they will be leaking very sensitive information. So this is Islamic fundamentalists, which will be hitting their campaign. Furthermore, they are likely to be using their position to finance the Islamic fundamentalists in their genocidal war against the Nigerian people. When Madu Sharif was the governor of Borno State, you will recollect his commissioner for finance and commissioner for inter-religious affairs were members of the Boko Haram group. And when eventually the Boko Haram people fell out with the government in Borno State and all over the Federation, one of the things that emboldened them to embark on the war that they are waging against the nation was the respect, was the position, was the opportunity that people like Madu Sharif gave to them, because it emboldened them. He gave them a false sense that they were also important in the society and that they could take on government and win, because the belief of Madu Sharif at that period in time was that the voice that will come from the Boko Haram people in Borno State is a black vote that should not be neglected. So that sent the wrong signal to the Boko Haram that they have arrived, that they can now compete with the Nigerian state. Not too long ago too, the chairman of the Senate Committee on the Army, which is Ali Ndume, had once been arraigned in court and prosecuted for having correspondences with the Boko Haram sect. He escaped justice merely based on technicalities. That certain persons were led to have gone to tamper with the court records, so that it made it difficult for the judge to be able to arrive at the decision. He probably would have arrived at if people have not tampered with court documents and all that.
Okay.
Furthermore, even Mr. President has once, he's also been accused of being a sympathizer of the Boko Haram. For example, before he became president, it was in the news that he said he would spend the rest of his life ensuring that Sharia law is practiced all over the Federation. When Dr. Goodluck Jonathan also began to hit the Boko Haram, and the army seems to be on the upper hand, President Muhammadu Buhari was also one of the persons that came out and said, look, the fight against the Boko Haram,
Mr. Kolawole,
the killing of the Boko Haram is a fight against the North.
All right, Mr. Kolawole, I want us to just, get you to speak on this, so we don't spend too much time on Mr. Pantami. Do you think that his statements from the early 2000s are enough to demand his resignation?
Of course. You can't have that kind of a person in that kind of sensitive place, and then you leave him there. If you leave him there, like I said, two possibilities are there. He's in a very sensitive ministry that compiles statistics and records of Nigerian citizens. So he could be leaking information. So the Islamic fundamentalist, he could also be using his privileged position to finance the Islamic fundamentalist. So to that extent, that person has no place in government. He's in too sensitive an area to continue to retain a day longer in that place.
Okay.
Okay, I wanted us to talk about this very important issue that we've seen on the Nigerian Tribune. We know that, you know, several, you know, zones in the country, several ethnic groups have been agitating for secession. And we've even seen the Ariel Onakankafo, Gani Adams, say that the Yoruba nation is moving away from secession to demanding for self-determination. The federal government here is, you know, speaking to Nigerians, telling them not to listen to secessionists. I have statements from Lai Mohammed here saying that you don't cure a headache by beheading the patient. So really, Mr. Kolawole, is secession, is self-determination, breaking away from Nigeria, having an independent state, would that be the solution to the security challenges that were seen in the country?
Honestly, it is unfortunate that we're having all this agitation, this rash of agitation all over the country. For me as a person, I'm a Pan-Africanist, I'm a Pan-Nigerianist. I don't believe in secession. And the reason why I don't believe in secession is very, very basic. I have done a study around the world and find out that most of the countries that are making giant strides all over the world today are those countries that have very huge population and very, very big land mass. When you have a huge population and a very, very big land mass, the possibilities are that the resources that will be available to you in terms of material and human resources will be so huge that you could do so many things. Unlike if the country were tiny and the human resources, the material resources were also tiny, and then you have little to play with in terms of carrying out experiments, in terms of traveling even to the space, in terms of exploring the depth of the ocean, in terms of carrying out all sorts of researches that are likely to benefit humanity. No matter how big Ghana may be, no matter how successful Ghana may be today, Ghana will still not be able to rate, will not be able to compete with Nigeria simply because of its small size and a very few little population. It is to that extent I don't believe in secession. But if you look at what is going on in our country today, in terms of irresponsible leadership, lack of visionary leadership, leadership that are giving tacit support to the secessionists, but will come out openly to denounce them, you want to ask yourself, rather than continue on this forced marriage, will it not be better for people to go their different ways so that they can have their peace and then their respective regions can be able to sleep with one eye closed? But the truth is that even when you do have secession, will it put an end to all these problems that we are talking about? It is very, very doubtful. Look at the history of the Yorubas. The Yorubas have fought more wars among themselves than they have ever fought against any external aggression or against any other tribes in the country. If you also look at the Igbos, they have fought more wars within themselves than they have ever fought against any external aggressor. Ditto for the Hausa people. And if you say you succeed today, the corruption that is at the bottom of most of the crisis that we have, is it going to be wished away overnight? Because all our allies, whether they be Hausas, whether they be Igbos, whether they be Yoruba, all of them are partakers in the monumental corruption that has led to this crisis of lack of peace that we have in our hand. All the leading elite and politicians have their private army and volunteer, private armies and fossil groups that are causing problems in the rural areas and then in the urban centers. And all this is likely to be wished away when you break up the country into different segments. The answer is no. I am not too sure that decision is our problem. Rather, I would want the Nigerian youth to concentrate the energy on ensuring that these different allies who are stoking the fire of the fire of corruption, who are heating up the polity, who appeal to tribal sentiment when they are at a disadvantage, when competing with other allies from the other region. We should deal with those ones and then unite our country and move forward.
Okay, Kolawole.
That is the way to go.
All right. Well, it's a conversation that we're going to be having a lot later on the show this morning. Let's move on to talk once again about the 60 billion naira controversy. On the Daily Independent, it says here the federal government should heed Obaseki's advice. PDP governors tell APC counterparts. But the APC is saying nothing wrong if CBN prints money during financial crisis. The month is going to be over in a bit. It's expectations that we either would once again be printing money, according to Governor Obaseki, or maybe we would be able to, you know, fund, you know, the FARC allocations without having to print money, you know. But what are your thoughts on the controversy concerning printing money at a time like this?
Well, I have looked at both the pros and the cons of the arguments of both who support the printing of money and those who don't support it. And I want to pitch my tent with those who are frowned very seriously against the printing of national currency. It is an heinous crime for anybody to do. And even if you are going to do it, or if you are compelled to do it, it should be the last resort. We have said it times without number. Why don't you look at the structure of this government and the cost of governance? Why don't you look at scaling down the bureaucracy? Why don't you cut the cost of contract? The cost of contract in this country is the highest in the world. Every contract that is awarded in the country today is denominated in billions. Take, for example, road construction. Most of the material that you require for road construction is granite, is sand, is bitumen, and iron. Most of these components are not imported from abroad. So why would road construction be denominated in billions? They are denominated in billions simply because half of that money is going to end up in some people's private pocket to prosecute their election and then live a life of indolence as against the rest of us. Furthermore, you are printing money to shore up the budget deficit. You still want to invest 1.5 billion naira in turnaround maintenance of a refinery that is not likely to work. Does that make sense? It doesn't make sense. It is for that reason that everybody should rise up and say no to this willful destruction of our national currency. That was what destroyed the Zimbabwe currency. That was what destroyed the Brazilian currency. That was what destroyed the Venezuelan currency. The international community will not sit by and allow Nigeria to be printing money and spending it. It's like you eating without sweating. Nobody is going to take that from you. What they are doing is already causing inflation. Even from their own agency, the National Office of Statistics, inflation rate is now put at 18.7%. That is outrageous. You go to the market now, everything has skyrocketed. Housing rentals have skyrocketed. You hardly can buy anything now without having a quantum of money. That is the consequences of people merely printing money rather than working for it. Hmm. And spending, not sweating.
Okay.
So I support the PDP. I also think I support Governor Obaseki. Printing, we haven't gotten to that level in which you start printing money. There are so many things that we can do to really generate revenue, to really run this government. Cut down the cost of government.
All right, Mr. Tunde Kolawole. Another big issue we're seeing is about coronavirus, you know, the vaccination, vaccine hesitancy, vaccine passport. On the Guardian newspaper, the headline reads, hurdles for air travelers as nations okays vaccine passports. It's nothing new, you know, for people to get vaccinated before they travel. I mean, we all know the popular yellow fever vaccination. To most countries, you need to have that before you're allowed, you know, entry into the country. But we know, you know, just how unprecedented the coronavirus is. All the conspiracy theories regarding the virus, the 5G conspiracy, all of that. And vaccine hesitancy with lots of people, you know, having thoughts about what the vaccine could do to their bodies. But we're seeing now that most destinations and airlines are insisting on COVID-19 passports, which is basically like a digital certificate that says, you know, you are low risk, you know, for the COVID-19 vaccine. So just your thoughts quickly on how this might affect tourism in the country and maybe even change the minds of people who are willing to travel regarding, you know, taking the coronavirus vaccine.
Well, honestly speaking, when you look around the world today, that appears to be the direction in which most countries are moving towards. The European, you know, for example, now have an e-certificate for COVID-19. Some other countries have adopted the same measure. Whatever is going to help humanity to conquer this virulent virus, I think should be supported by all of us. But here at home, the question will be, something that you can produce, can you really have a control over it? Most of the vaccines that are being used in Nigeria today are either donated to us by some of these other countries. Whereas in an ideal manner, we should be able to produce a vaccine locally. If India, for example, is able to produce it, if we as a nation had in the past been producing vaccines against even more deadly diseases than this COVID-19 thing. So, for me, if we require the certificate and Nigerians don't have it, I think it will also be good news to me. Because the tourism that our people do, they merely use it to carry money outside the country. Let all Nigerians sit down, pack at home in here, and find solutions to our problem. In fact, if we can shut the borders of the country and disallow people from traveling for the next 10 years or thereabouts, I am sure most of the challenges that we have as a nation will begin to find solutions to it.
All right. Mr. Kolawole, a lot of people would disagree with you there. You know, people should be allowed freedom of movement, you know, freedom to find opportunities wherever they can.
The tourism industry is not even thriving. The tourism industry is not thriving in Nigeria. It is only Nigeria that visits places. Other nations hardly come to Nigeria because most of our tourism facilities, we have refused to develop them. And the high level of insecurity that we have in the country today, we never encourage any foreigner to come into this country today, coming to this holiday.
All right.
For the past few weeks now, there has been no light all over the country. So who citizens of other nations will come into this kind of environment? Nigeria has become an oval in the last few weeks or thereabouts.
But the sad thing though is that just a slight deviation, the sad thing is that when foreigners come to our country, they get paid, you know, times 10 of the locals in the country. They live in the best neighborhoods, you know, they live the best lives. They live better than the average Nigerian.
And move around with armed policemen.
That is true. When you compare the tourists that go from China, for example, to the European Union, or even to Germany, or to Spain, and all that, who don't even have the kind of endowment in terms of tourism that we have. What a value is that? The number of Europeans who come into this country, or even foreigners who come into this country for tourist activities, are very, very minimal. Most of the ones you are referring to are businessmen who know that when they take very huge risks to come into this country, they are likely to live very plentiful harvest. We see them in gold mining all over the country, mining gold without paying royalties. We see them mining gemstones without paying royalties.
Right, Tunekola,
we see them taking away our marbles without paying royalties.
No, it's all just, you know, symptoms of a system that isn't working. But Tunekola, thank you very much for your time this morning. Thanks for starting off our week for us.
Thank you.
And we wish you a great week ahead.
Thanks for having me.
All right.
I wish the two of you a very lovely week ahead.
Thank you.
You too, sir. All right, stay with us. We're going to Today in History. Next, we're going to the year 2011 to tell you about one of the longest serving presidents in history. And of course, his brother, you know, I might just throw in a little bit of information on his brother also.
Yes, and we're talking about something that gave us a bit of light and laughter, you know, during the coronavirus pandemic last year. Stay with us.